It's really interesting when I think about DJ Jazzy J, and I know a lot of people in New York know about him, but don't realize that he's part of the Bias family, and we still have the Biases on St. Helena Island, just a couple miles away from here, down Seaside Road, as well as those that are on Ladies Island, where Jazzy grew up. And so I know back in the day, as folks would say, when he was growing up, there was a lot of differences than what you see today.
First of all, I was born and raised down there, and for me, it was like, you know, being a country boy that I am, you know, you can take the boy out of the country, but you ain't gonna never take the country out of him, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, I always had my upbringing, like, you know, for my grandmother, who actually raised me. And of course, I was born in an environment where, you know, we had much family in South Carolina, and everybody treated everybody with utmost respect, you know, whether they didn't have any money or nothing like that, everybody was still happy in their existence, you know what I'm saying? We lived in little shacks and little, you know, houses that, you know, would probably be deemed subpar at this time, but back then, we was happy with what we had, you know what I'm saying? We lived off the land, you know what I'm saying? I remember my earliest years, you know, just like running around in the fields, you know, barefoot, chasing after chickens, going in the fields, pulling a watermelon out the ground and just kind of like hitting it on the ground till it opens up, and then you just dig in and eat what you want and rest, put it right back down to the earth, you know? And, you know, those are like the best memories I can, you know, just remember, besides just growing up in an environment where, you know, I had so many elders. We had a certain pride about us, you know, we was proud of where we came from, and the roots, you know, even though we didn't speak that the Queen's English, as they so speak, you know what I'm saying? Our English was always broken down, and I didn't understand this until when I moved to New York, and then everybody was like looking at me like, what he said? And I thought I was just speaking English, and then, you know, didn't know it was a dialect that was like not really followed by a lot of people outside of Frogmore, Tom Fripp, or, you know, the Gullah Islands over there where I was from. You know, you leave out of there, you go a little bit up north a little bit, you know, a little piece up the road, a little more, whatever, or down yonder. You go down yonder a piece and they wouldn't know what the hell you was talking about. I could be 3 or 4 years old, wander down the field and end up in somebody else's backyard. And they, oh, that's Miss Eula's grandson. You know, I'll end up in Miss Mary's yard or down Coosaw Road. And they're like, oh, ain't that so-and-so, son? And they'll grab me up and deliver me back to my grandmother, whatever the deal is. But it was a whole neighborhood, not even a neighborhood, it was a whole tribe. And then that was the ideology, you know, from our original ideology. It takes a whole tribe to raise a child. Granny was like more or less, you know, the local witch doctor, you know, and she wasn't, you know, by herself. These were remedies that were passed down, you know, through the times, because, you know, you didn't go to the store and get no bear aspirins or some Anacins or some Tylenol. When you got sick, you know what I'm saying, they had the old world remedies, you know what I'm saying? They'd go out in the fields and grab some leaves from this tree, and, you know, they knew exactly what to grab, what to mix it with, and they'd mix up a batch of some nasty tasting whatever it was. But you know what? After you took that and you did your thing, you felt a lot better. You know what I'm saying? People lived down there to be, you know, 80 and 90 years in a time, 90 years old, in a time when people were dying at the age of 50s and 60s and all of that, you know what I'm saying? And in general, like, people down there, because we lived off of the land and a lot of the stuff wasn't filled with a lot of, you know, a lot of chemicals and steroids or whatever the deal was, you know what I'm saying? People ate a lot better because of the fact that you raised and you ate from the land. That's where a lot of people migrated from the South. They always ended up in Harlem first, so that's where we ended up. We ended up in Harlem. That was, you know, my introduction to the city life, and at a young age. But then I found out when I got to New York, I had a whole host of cousins, and, you know, they were all my age, and we kind of all grew up together like a little mob. You know what I'm saying? It was just a mob. But back in those days, you know, black folks was making a lot of babies back in the 60s, so it wasn't until like some years later that, you know, we would have to leave Harlem because we were there to devastating fire in the building. We got relocated to some sort of like little shelter situation. At that time, there for a while, then that's when we got relocated to the place that would kind of set the tone for the person named Jazzy J. When I moved from there, we moved to 174th Street and Harrod Avenue, Bronx River Projects. When I was in Harlem, I knew about the Black Spades because, you know, the gangs was, they were there, but it wasn't as evident to me because of the fact that, you know, the gangs were, you know, these were, we lived in tenement buildings, and, you know, the gangs were scattered, like some people lived on some blocks, blah, blah, blah. They would all get together and, you know, maybe in the park, Riverside Park or whatever the deal is, and then, you know, do they, blah, 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 their business, and, you know, you'd see them with the colors, but they wouldn't gather. Now, when you go to Bronx River, the gangs were all right there in the project, so you couldn't help but to see all of that. And now, I'm going to the Bronx with my South Carolina demeanor, which is like, you know, we don't take no shit from no boy. We from the country, and we will whip your tail, all right? Then I got my Harlem demeanor. Man, I'll kick your from Harlem, USA, baby. You know, Harlem, we don't play. This is Harlem, USA. You know what I'm saying? I get to the Bronx, and I start talking this right away. I'm Harlem signifying. Yeah, you know, yeah, Harlem born, baby. You know, Harlem, USA. You know what I'm saying? Timothy Cooper, Haldorf, and yam me right in the face. Boom! Like, wow, didn't see that one coming. Yo, you in the Bronx now. I was like, okay, maybe I should just tune this Harlem thing down a little bit. At least stop down in the Bronx and start getting with the program since I do live here now.